Hey, this is Dr. Emil Tompkins. I want to thank you for joining me on the Beyond Pain Relief podcast. Today's episode, your mind may be more important than your DNA in our exercise and eating habits.
You are listening to the Beyond the Pain podcast, where Dr. Emil Tompkins and his guest guide you through the latest techniques to relieve your pain and learn how to fuel, move, and think for lifetime wellness.
Guys, there is a study, and I'm just going to get it out right now, and then we'll go into more detail. If you tell people they have a genetic predisposition to not be able to exercise well or to overeat, if you just tell them that, they will live it out. So you got to watch how you speak with people. Guys, just in time to confuse people who have received genetic testing kits for the holidays, there's a new study that finds that if you tell people they have a genetic predisposition to certain health characteristics, such as a low capacity for exercise or a tendency to overeat, their bodies start to respond accordingly, even if their DNA doesn't actually contain those genes. Crazy, right? There's a study. It raises some big questions about the extent to which our genes affect our physical well-being and whether, in some instances, our beliefs about our bodies, our capabilities, and limits might be even more influential than the actual gene studies. DNA testing is really trendy at the moment. Over-the-counter and prescription testing services promise to tell us about our health inheritance, including whether we're prone to weight gain, will respond well to exercise, can metabolize various foods efficiently, and face heightened or reduced risks for a broad range of medical conditions. The accuracy of many of these claims, however, remains in doubt. Most scientists who study genetics consider the effects of many particular gene variants on health to be generally slight and still poorly understood. But even less is known about the psychological impacts of learning that you might have a high or a low genetic risk for health and fitness problems and how our subsequent attitudes might play out in our physiology. So for the new study, this was a study published in December in Nature Human Behavior. Researchers at Stanford University set out to confuse, to fool a large group of men and women about their genetics, at least temporarily. So they started by advertising locally for participants interested in learning which diet or exercise program is best suited for them based on their genes. So more than 200 healthy men and women responded. They were accepted into the study. And so each provided first a saliva sample for genotyping, after which the experiment began, although its actual intent was hidden from the participants, and we'll get into that. So the men and women were divided into two groups. One group completed a treadmill test, during which they ran as long as possible while wearing a mask that measured their oxygen uptake, their VO2 max, and their lung capacity. And occasionally they're telling the researchers how they felt. So that was the first thing. They're on the treadmill, hard as possible, as long as possible. Tell people how you're feeling when you're working out. Then the next group, they focused on their diets and their eating behaviors. These people were given a 480-calorie liquid meal. They were told to finish it and then describe how full they felt, while the researchers were drawing blood to test the level of certain hormones that are known to be involved in making people feel satisfied or not. Later, on a separate visit to the lab, the volunteers learned their genetic test results. Some of those in the exercise group were told that, you know, you have a particular gene variant that makes you feel like you have low endurance and find that exercise is difficult. And this gene variant, it exists and it's associated with a low response to endurance training. So they were told, okay, you have this gene, you're going to have low endurance, you're not going to feel like exercise is helping you. They were told this, but the participants that were told this actually didn't have that gene. All right. Now, similarly, in the diet group, the researchers told some of those people, again, incorrectly, that, hey, you guys carry the gene that's going to reduce how full you feel, so it's going to make you want to overeat. On the other way around, that gene will make you feel full quickly and reduce your risk of obesity. So afterward, the men and women, they did treadmill test again. They did the meal session again, and the results were outrageous. So the people who were in the exercise group that were told that their genes made them not respond well to exercise or that their genes were going to make them tired more quickly, these guys got tired more quickly now than they did at their first workout. And their oxygen uptake and their lung capacity were lower than they were in the very first test that they did before they were told about their genetic results. So just being told about your genetic results are going to influence how well you're able to exercise, influence how much you get out of your exercise, even when you're told the wrong thing. In the diet group, the people who thought that they had the protective variant of the gene, they felt fuller after drinking the shake. In both cases, your psychological beliefs about your genetic risks altered the response to the testing. So you could be incorrect. You can hear that you have the genetic predisposition to not gain much from your exercise. And you know what? You're then going to not gain much from your exercise. You could be told that you have the genetic predisposition to not get full quickly enough and overeat. And you know what? You just might then, after being told that, not feel like you're full quickly enough and overeat. These tests actually made more difference. The psychological group had more of a difference in their exercise result than the actual people who had the gene. So if I was told that I had the gene that was going to make me not gain a great benefit from my exercise, and then when in fact I do have the gene that says I'm going to have great benefit from exercise, I am so much more likely to have a change in response based on what I've been told instead of what actually is the case. This is powerful. It's powerful, and it shows how our beliefs, what we believe is true, how important that is when it comes to making a difference in our health. If you believe that you don't benefit from exercise, if you tell yourself, I'm just not that good at the gym, or if you tell yourself, you know, I just can't imagine going to CrossFit, or if you tell yourself that I just don't have time or whatever, our beliefs about our exercise are going to affect our benefit. If you tell yourself untruths about diet, if you tell yourself, well, I just need to eat these certain things, or I just struggle with my weight, or I just struggle with making good decisions for food, the more you tell yourself or the more you've been told, that's going to have a greater impact on your health than what actually is true. Watch that. So you're going to have to think about, what kinds of things are you telling yourself, and what kinds of things are you hearing from others? And if you're surrounded by people who are going to encourage you, who are going to lead you to be healthier, to do more with your health, then great, you're in good shape. And if you listen to that, you're going to have more success. If you're telling yourself positive things about yourself and your health and what you can do and what you can accomplish, you're going to have better success. If you believe that you're going to struggle, you're going to struggle. Even if there's no real physical reason why you should struggle, you will. Your mindset will affect your health benefits of the things that you do. We have a previous podcast episode number 14, that talks about this when it comes to our pain, how our mindset affects our pain. It is a battle that we have to fight. And if you can win that battle of your mind, then you're going to win that battle for your health. And I know that's what you're after. Hey guys, I'm Dr. Emil Tompkins. I hope you have a great day, and we will see you soon.
Hey guys, it's Dr. Emil Tompkins. Many people fail to make a change in their health until things are drastic, until we've gone so far that it's so challenging to make that change, or we feel like it's almost too late, and then we're much more reluctant to make those changes in our health. This is a problem, and it needs to change. It needs to stop. When you find something that has an opportunity to make a difference in your health or in the health of someone around you, I invite you to take that opportunity to make that change for yourself or for someone you know. So I have a favor to ask of you. If you've listened to this podcast and you feel like there's something here that you think will benefit someone that you know, I invite you to share that podcast with them. There's a share link on the bottom of the screen. I want you to click that share button to share this with others. Give others the opportunity to experience the Beyond Pain Relief podcast. Share that with others. Make a difference in the health of someone around you. And I thank you so much for doing that. This is Dr. Emil Tompkins. Thank you for joining us on the Beyond Pain Relief podcast. And thank you for making a difference in the lives of the people around you. Have a great day.
You are listening to the Beyond the Pain podcast, where Dr. Emil Tompkins and his guests guide you through the latest techniques to relieve your pain and learn how to fuel, move, and think for lifetime wellness.